Hello, I'm Dr. Maria Corcoran from the University of Washington. In this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I will review the basics of management of hepatitis C and HIV co-infection. Co-infection with hepatitis C and HIV is common owing to shared risk factors, and all persons with HIV should be screened for hepatitis C. Among persons living with HIV in the United States, an estimated 15 to 30% have hepatitis C co-infection, and in the U.S., approximately 5% of persons with chronic hepatitis C have HIV co-infection. Although historically rates of hepatitis C co-infection have been highest among persons with HIV who inject drugs, data over the past 10 years or so has shown that men who have sex with men living with and without HIV are also at elevated risk for hepatitis C via sexual transmission. In a recent systematic review and meta-analysis evaluating hepatitis C prevalence and incidence in men who have sex with men, the pooled hepatitis C prevalence was 3.4%. However, when stratified for HIV status, the prevalence of hepatitis C was considerably higher among MSM living with HIV at 6.3% when compared to MSM without HIV, who had a hepatitis C prevalence of 1.5%. Similarly, when evaluating the incidence of hepatitis C among HIV-negative MSM, authors of this study found that the incidence was significantly higher among MSM on PrEP when compared to those not on PrEP, suggesting shared risk factors for HIV and hepatitis C among this group. Diagnosing HIV and hepatitis C co-infection remains critically important, as co-infection can accelerate the progression of hepatic fibrosis, and patients with HIV and hepatitis C co-infection are less likely to spontaneously clear the hepatitis C virus. Similarly, cirrhosis has been observed to occur 12 to 16 years earlier in persons with HIV and hepatitis C co-infection when compared to those with hepatitis C alone, and up to 80 to 90% of liver-related deaths in persons with HIV are attributable to hepatitis C infection. However, this faster progression to liver fibrosis and cirrhosis can be mitigated by curing hepatitis C with direct-acting antivirals or DAAs. And in the modern DAA era, hepatitis C treatment is recommended for nearly everyone with hepatitis C infection, regardless of HIV status. Owing to the safety and tolerability of DAAs, the pre-treatment assessment has become much more streamlined and can generally be done within a single clinic visit. Assessing the degree of fibrosis is an important aspect of the pre-treatment assessment, as it identifies those with cirrhosis who would benefit from routine hepatocellular carcinoma screening. There are several ways to assess for fibrosis, including non-invasive laboratory testing, FibroScan, and liver biopsy. The FIB-4 is a commonly used non-invasive measure of fibrosis, which is calculated based on a patient's age, platelet count, AST, and ALT, and has been validated in patients with HIV co-infection. FibroScan, or transient elastography, uses an ultrasound transducer probe to measure shear wave velocity through the liver, which correlates directly with liver stiffness. FibroScan is an accurate, non-invasive, and fairly quick way of assessing the degree of liver fibrosis, but it does require access to a FibroScan machine. Liver biopsy, which remains the gold standard for assessing liver fibrosis, is rarely used owing to safer and easier methods for assessing liver fibrosis. In addition to assessing the degree of liver fibrosis, a basic laboratory workup including CBC, CMP, hepatitis C RNA, and hepatitis B serologic testing is recommended. Hepatitis C genotype testing is rarely required but should be sent in patients with underlying cirrhosis prior to the use of Sofosbuvir-Velpatasvir, as resistance testing is recommended in patients with genotype 3 and cirrhosis prior to use of Sofosbuvir-Velpatasvir. And finally, a careful medication history should be obtained to screen for potential drug-drug interactions. Although persons with HIV were historically considered a hard-to-treat population during the interferon era, data from multiple studies indicate that SVR12 rates or cure rates are comparable among persons with hepatitis C monoinfection and hepatitis C and HIV co-infection in this modern DAA era, regardless of the treatment regimen used. In the following slides, I will review the data supporting the use of Glecaprevir-Pibrentasvir and Sofosbuvir-Velpatasvir, the two most commonly used DAA regimens in the United States. Glecaprevir-Pibrentasvir is the first pangenotypic NS34A protease inhibitor and NS5A inhibitor combination to be approved that offers a potent treatment option for the vast majority of patients with chronic hepatitis C. This drug is not an option for patients with decompensated cirrhosis, given the presence of a protease inhibitor. In the main registration trials for treatment-naive individuals, sustained virologic response rates, or SVR12 rates, for 8 weeks of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir were in the range of 95% or greater, with very few, if any, on-treatment virologic breakthroughs or post-treatment relapses. The Expedition 2 trial was an open-label Phase 3 trial evaluating the safety and efficacy of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir for 8 or 12 weeks in persons with HIV and hepatitis C co-infection with or without compensated cirrhosis. Adults with any hepatitis C genotype were eligible, provided they had a hepatitis C RNA greater than or equal to 1,000 at the time of screening, were treatment naive, or had received prior treatment with pegylated interferon with or without ribavirin or sofosbuvir. Persons with HIV co-infection needed to be on ART or be ART naive with a CD4 count greater than 500. In total, 137 persons without cirrhosis were enrolled and given 8 weeks of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir, and 16 persons with cirrhosis were enrolled and given 12 weeks of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir. In the intention-to-treat analysis, 98% of persons achieved an SVR12, with 99 achieving an SVR12 in the modified intention-to-treat analysis. When stratified by cirrhosis, 100% of those without cirrhosis achieved an SVR12 after 8 weeks of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir versus 93% of those with cirrhosis following 12 weeks of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir. Sofosbuvir-Velpatasvir is a pangenotypic NS5A, NS5B inhibitor single-pill combination regimen that has potent activity against hepatitis C. In contrast to glecaprevir-pibrentasvir, it can be used safely in patients with decompensated cirrhosis as it does not contain a protease inhibitor. In the main registration trials, SVR12 rates for treatment-naive individuals were in the range of 95% or greater, with very few, if any, on-treatment virologic breakthroughs or post-treatment relapses. The ASTRAL-5 trial was a single-arm, open-label, multi-center Phase 3 trial of sofosbuvir-velpatasvir in HIV and hepatitis C co-infected individuals with genotype 1 through 6 with and without compensated cirrhosis. The trial included persons 18 years of age and older with HIV co-infection who had a CD4 count greater than or equal to 100 and a suppressed viral load on a stable regimen of ART for at least 8 weeks. Prior treatment failure was allowed, but patients could not have failed a prior NS5A or NS5B regimen. In total, 106 persons with HIV and hepatitis C co-infection were enrolled and given 12 weeks of sofosbuvir-velpatasvir. When stratified by genotype, SVR12 rates range from 92 to 100%, with only 2 hepatitis C virologic relapses in the genotype 1A group. Similarly, when stratified by prior treatment experience or cirrhosis status, 93% of treatment-naive individuals versus 97% of treatment-experienced individuals achieved an SVR12. Among those without cirrhosis, 94% achieved an SVR12 versus 100% of those with compensated cirrhosis. The MINMON study, or Minimal Monitoring Study, was a Phase 4 open-label single-arm trial examining the safety and efficacy of a minimal monitoring approach to hepatitis C care and delivery using 12 weeks of sofosbuvir-velpatasvir in treatment-naive persons with and without HIV co-infection. To be eligible for this study, participants had to be 18 years of age or older, have a hepatitis C RNA greater than 1,000, be treatment-naive, and not have hepatitis B virus co-infection. HIV co-infection and compensated cirrhosis were both permitted. In this study, there were no pretreatment genotyping, and cirrhosis was determined by FIB4. All treatment medications were provided on entry, and there were no scheduled on-treatment visits or labs. Investigators checked in with participants via phone at week 4 and 22, with SVR12 labs drawn per convention at week 24. Of note, 42% of persons enrolled in this study had HIV co-infection, nearly all of whom were virally suppressed on ART at study entry. Collectively, 95% of persons in the MINMON study achieved an SVR12, including 95% of those with hepatitis C monoinfection and 95% of those with HIV and hepatitis C co-infection. Collectively, these trial results, among others, have led the Guideline Committee on Opportunistic Infections to recommend the following hepatitis C treatment regimens among persons living with HIV. For hepatitis C treatment-naive individuals without cirrhosis, the preferred regimens are either glecaprevir-pibrentasvir for 8 weeks or sofosbuvir-velpatasvir for 12 weeks. For treatment-naive individuals with compensated cirrhosis, the preferred regimens are glecaprevir-pibrentasvir for 8 weeks or sofosbuvir-velpatasvir for 12 weeks. Of note, while the 12-week course of glecaprevir-pibrentasvir is better studied in patients with HIV co-infection, real-world data suggests that 8 weeks is sufficient in this population, and as such, the 12-week duration is listed as an alternative in the OI guidelines. Additionally, for patients with compensated cirrhosis and genotype 3, the use of sofosbuvir-velpatasvir requires pretreatment NS5A resistance-associated substitution testing, and therefore glecaprevir-pibrentasvir for 8 weeks is preferred in this group. Sofosbuvir-velpatasvir is okay to use if no resistance is present among persons with genotype 3 and cirrhosis. If resistance is present and glecaprevir-pibrentasvir cannot be used, then the addition of ribavirin to sofosbuvir-velpatasvir is recommended. Thankfully, glecaprevir-pibrentasvir and sofosbuvir-velpatasvir are well tolerated when taken with frontline ART regimens with few drug-drug interactions. Because glecaprevir-pibrentasvir contains a protease inhibitor, this regimen is contraindicated in patients on PIs for HIV treatment, but sofosbuvir-velpatasvir can be used in the setting of HIV PIs. There are also several drug-drug interactions between both glecaprevir-pibrentasvir and sofosbuvir-velpatasvir with older NNRTIs, including efavirenz and etravirine. But thankfully, due to limited use of these NNRTIs, these drug-drug interactions rarely come up in clinical practice. Most patients will not need any on-treatment monitoring. Due to the risk for symptomatic hypoglycemia in patients taking medications for diabetes concurrently with direct-acting antivirals, persons on diabetes medication should undergo routine blood sugar monitoring. Similarly, patients on warfarin should be informed of the potential for changes in their anticoagulation status while on DAA therapy and undergo INR monitoring for subtherapeutic anticoagulation. Although the risk of liver decompensation during DAA therapy is rare, clinicians may choose to monitor liver function tests in patients with compensated cirrhosis while on hepatitis C treatment. When done, this monitoring typically occurs monthly. Finally, all patients should undergo repeat hepatitis C RNA and liver function testing at 12 weeks following the completion of hepatitis C therapy to evaluate for hepatitis C cure and normalization of liver transaminase levels, respectively. To conclude, HIV and hepatitis C co-infection is common owing to shared risk factors. Co-infection with HIV accelerates the progression of hepatic fibrosis in patients with hepatitis C, and hepatitis C is the leading cause of liver-related deaths in persons living with HIV. Glecaprevir-pibrentasvir and sofosbuvir-velpatasvir are the preferred regimens to treat hepatitis C in patients with and without HIV due to their efficacy and pangenotypic activity. Many patients with HIV can be treated for hepatitis C using a minimal monitoring approach, and most will not need on-treatment monitoring. Preferred hepatitis C treatment regimens have limited interactions with most first-line ART, but important drug-drug interactions with PIs and NNRTIs do exist. To learn more about HIV, please check out the National HIV Curriculum, which contains a variety of lessons, cases, and slides to reinforce your knowledge. Thanks for joining me today.
The production of this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture was supported by funding from the Health Resources and Services Administration.